What's up, ICB? Man, so eager to jump into the scriptures that God has given us to get some wisdom from God. I am certain that he has something awesome to teach us today from his word. And we're going to be jumping into his word in Nehemiah chapter 13. And guys, that's the last chapter of Ezra and Nehemiah, which means that it's the last sermon in our series, Building a Church, Rebuilding a City. It has been an awesome series. And the thing is you can go back and listen to all the messages in this series on our app or on our website. So go check it out. Especially last week's message from John Carano when he spoke on the spiritual discipline of gratitude in Nehemiah chapter 12. Go check it out. Today, like I said, we are going to be jumping into Nehemiah chapter 13. But before we do, let's pray. Our Father, you're a good father and a good king. And all good things come from you. And we're so thankful for your scriptures. I'm thankful for the opportunity to open them up and study them. And Lord, we know that you're bigger than us. You're far bigger and greater than us. And we're not studying you under a microscope, but we're looking up into the heavens to see who you are. Lord, we ask for wisdom as we open up these scriptures. Make us wise and help us to become more like your son, Jesus. We pray all this in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Now, for those of you who are around kids frequently or are parents, you know all of the problems that can arise when your kids go unsupervised, right? And for those of you who aren't around kids a lot, we've all been kids before, and we know all the problems that, all the trouble we got in when we were unsupervised. So we can think back to that. So first, I wanna just give you guys a little bit of wisdom, some kid care wisdom, two pieces. And the first part is that kids are loud. They're gonna sing loud and play loud. They're gonna shout in the other room. And honestly, even though that's annoying, it's normal and it's safe. Because if they're off in the other room screaming and shouting and playing, at least you know they're not choking and dying. The real problem comes, number two, when it's been really quiet for a long time and you don't know where your kids are and they're unsupervised. That's when you have real problems. It could be a physical danger problem that you have to go save them, or more often than not, they're just being naughty in the other room, right? So about a year ago, Issa, the very talented girl from Panama who leads us in worship here at ICB, she was our roommate and she is great with kids. And so from time to time, she would watch our kids. While she was staying with us, though, we had one rule, and the rule is that our kids could not go into her room. A, because we wanted to make sure that she had a space all to her own so that she could escape from our crazy loud family whenever she needed to. And B, because our kids would always sneak in there and touch her stuff, especially Margot. Margot was obsessed with her chapstick. So one day, Issa is watching Margot all alone. They finish lunch, there's some quiet time. Margot is playing alone really well, so Issa sits down to look at some messages on her phone. And after a while of complete silence, the little alarm in Issa's head starts to go off, saying it has been too quiet for too long, and she goes and searches for Margot. And so she says, Margot, where are you? No answer. She goes and looks in Margot's room, she's not there. She looks all over the house and ends at her room, and she slowly pushes the door open. And sure enough, Margot is in the room, completely entranced by Issa's chapstick, just like she's Smeagol from Lord of the Rings, looking at it. She doesn't even know Issa is there. And so Issa, to get her attention, raises her voice and says, Margot! And Margot instantly puts the chapstick on, puts the cap back on, and throws it away to hide the evidence. Oh man, kids are just like this all the time. They do the exact thing you tell them not to do when they're unsupervised. But the thing is, if we're honest, as adults, not much has changed. We go to the doctor, and the doctor says, you're not well, you need to start eating healthy. But then when no one's looking at midnight, we're there pounding a tub of ice cream. Or if we're strapped financially, if we're in a difficult time financially, and there's that new shiny thing in the window of the storefront that we see, and we just have to have it, and we buy it irresponsibly. And then it goes deeper, right? Spiritually. We know we're supposed to be meditating and studying on the scriptures, praying without ceasing. But guys, life comes at us fast. and it gets hard, and then we start to let the important things fall away. We start to compromise. And at best, the little things start to fall away, and at worst, we lose our faith entirely. But, well, friends, we're not the only ones. You see, in Nehemiah chapter 13, this is exactly what happens when Nehemiah leaves his children, his followers, unsupervised. You see, in between chapters 12 and 13, Nehemiah has to go back to Persia to see Artaxerxes as part of the original agreement, to let him know, look at all the things that we have accomplished. And while when he returns, it is absolute disaster. And that's what chapter 13 is all about. It's long, so I'm going to summarize it. First, Nehemiah comes back and he finds out that the Israelites have completely and universally banned everything foreign in the kingdom. And I'm still in process about this. If you've heard my last sermon, you know that there's part of me that says 99% of these foreigners are going to lead the people astray and bring them to worship other gods. And then on the other side of the debate, to say that you're going to ban everything foreign, that's not biblical. And what about that 1%? What about all the other characters in the Bible who were foreign that God loved and they did wonderful things through him? So I just don't want to be Pharisaic in that. But that's not the craziest part. Number two, when Nehemiah returns, he sees the worst of all people who just so happens to be a foreigner living in the temple itself, defiling it. The Levites have set up a little Airbnb in the temple storehouse for Tobiah. Do you guys remember Tobiah? Tobiah, through about half of the narrative of Nehemiah, is trying to intimidate, criticize, and attack Nehemiah so that he does not complete the walls. And so Nehemiah's anger starts to build, and he kicks this guy out of the temple and throws him out with all of his stuff. Third, Nehemiah continues to ask questions about the temple, and he finds out that all of the Levites have returned to working in fields. Why? Because no one is tithing. No one is making sacrifices and giving them what they're due. They can't survive, so they have to pick up second jobs. And so he's so frustrated. He has to cleanse the temple, recruit back all of the Levites and put them in their posts. And then he kind of offers up a self-congratulatory prayer, patting himself on the back saying, "Remember me for this, oh my God." So back to the story. Phase one of the project, the temple, has been completely defiled. The part that Zerubbabel initiated in the book of Ezra, the people couldn't follow the rules. Fourth, Nehemiah then discovers that tons of people are working on the Sabbath, which is an absolute no-no in the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. And where are they working on the Sabbath? On and by the city walls, which was Nehemiah's very own project. So phase two and phase three of the story are also being defiled. The reestablishment of the Torah, God's word, and the rebuilding of the city walls. And Nehemiah is so mad. He then goes and he forces the Levites to stand guard, and he tells them to use physical violence to prevent anyone from working on the Sabbath. And then he kind of pats himself on the back again and says, "Remember me for this, oh my God." The fifth thing, and finally, is when his anger really hits the ceiling. He goes and he sees that most of his men are marrying foreign women, which will lead them to worship other gods. And his solution to the problem is to rebuke them, curse them, beat them up, and pull out their hair. And then he forces them to take an oath that they will follow God, and we don't even know what the oath says. And then he prays to God, "Remember them, remember them." And that's not the same as "Remember me, oh God, for the good things I've done." He's saying, "Strike them down and kill them." And in the end, he purifies the land of everything foreign. He assigns them duties, and he pats himself on the back one more time. "Remember me for this, oh my God." Wow. What an ending to this narrative. I mean, one chapter earlier, we were celebrating. We had tons of gratitude in our hearts. They had accomplished what they set out to do. And then chapter 13 comes and boom, the leadership and the people blow up. They blow up. Why in the world would God put this story in the Bible? Why would he leave chapter 13 in? Couldn't he have ended it in chapter 12 with gratitude? Wouldn't that have been better, God? No, God has given us these scriptures for a reason, and he is gonna make us wise through these scriptures. So we're gonna find out at least three things that are gonna make us wise from this chapter, and that is, number one, we are no better than these people. Number two, you can't force someone to follow God. And number three, this is the end of Nehemiah, but it is not the climax of God's story. And above and beyond all of that, if you get nothing from this sermon, what I want you to understand is that every human needs a whole heart transformation that comes only from Jesus in order to love and obey God. Let me repeat that. Every human being needs a whole heart transformation from Jesus and Jesus alone in order to love and obey God. Because friends, no Jesus, no revival. The first important piece of wisdom that we gain from the story is that we're no better than these people who are making these mistakes. On the liberal side of things, on the left, we would say, why would Nehemiah beat people up and pull out their hair to force them to follow God? And why would they ban everything foreign from the land? And some of us who are more conservative on the right-hand side of things would say, oh, Nehemiah gave them clear instructions, and how could they be so sinful while he was away? How could they do that? And we start to think that these people are so inferior to us. They're so stupid. That's a normal thing, a natural thing. But as I've mentioned before, natural doesn't always mean good. Yes, there's cultural distance. Yes, there's distance in time from these people. And that brings us to these thoughts. But the Bible, by leaving this story in, what God leaving this story in is telling us, don't do that. We are no better than these characters in the scriptures. You see, a long time ago, C.S. Lewis and his friend Owen Barfield, they coined a phrase called chronological snobbery. Now, snobbery means that you think that you're better than others, and chronological has to do with time. So what they meant by this is when people in modern day look back on ancient cultures and see them drawing in caves or living in tents or making sacrifices or making mistakes like this, they think, wow, what idiots, what fools. And that's the exact thing that we're not supposed to do because it's not biblical. In a sense, it's true. We're progressing as humans. We're getting better science, technology, medicine. That's all true. But friends, spiritually, nothing has changed. Not a thing has changed. In fact, there's a whole book in the Old Testament called Ecclesiastes that talks about this. And it says over and over and over, there is nothing new under the sun. We are no better than them, so we must remember to humble ourselves and ask God to humble us as we read these stories. We have to go to the humblest one because he's the one who can truly change our hearts and provide that humility. No Jesus, no revival. Not only should we ask for humility, but we need to be self-aware of the characters that we're aligning ourselves with in each of these biblical stories. Most of us look at like the prodigal son and we say, oh, I'm the prodigal son. And in a sense, that's true. But as we progress in the Christian life, what parts of us are like the older brother? What parts of us are like the Pharisees? Because we should be seeing ourselves in those characters as well. The one I hear the most is when the slaves come out of Egypt and they go into the desert and they're wandering around and they start complaining and whining and they say, I wanna go back to be a slave because the food was better there. And people I teach that, they say, what? What idiots? Who would wanna go back and be a slave for better food, for pleasure? But friends, spiritually, we do this all the time. For those of us who have asked Jesus to come into our life, to his spirit to live inside of us and change us and transform us, he has given us the key to unlock the chains of slavery, to give us the power to overcome sin. It says in Galatians 5:1, for it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Christ has defeated sin, Satan, and death through his life, death, and resurrection. And he has given us the spiritual key to unlock the handcuffs of slavery, the handcuffs of sin in our life. And it's awesome when we go to God and we say, God, release me from this. And he does. But isn't it true that many times in our life we say, man, you remember those handcuffs that I used to wear? Oh man, do you remember what it felt like to be on my wrist? Oh yeah, it was good, right? I remember it feeling, I was comfortable with those on. Maybe I should put them on again and try it out. And then when we sin again, like our old ways, when we go back into slavery, then we're hooked and we're exactly where we didn't want to be. We're no different than the people in the Bible. And that is why God gives us these stories to remember, because to be human is to forget. So our challenge is to remind each other, to remind ourselves by studying the scriptures that we're no better than these people and that we need Jesus to be revived, because friends, no Jesus, no revival. That's not the only piece of wisdom that we gain from Nehemiah chapter 13 and the whole narrative. This next piece of wisdom that we gain is that we can never force someone to follow God. In the narrative, we see Nehemiah come back to a total and complete disaster. He comes back and his worst enemy, Tobiah, is set up in a little Airbnb in the temple. The Levites have allowed it. No one is making sacrifices or tithing, so all the Levites have to get second jobs. Everyone's doing work on the Sabbath, and they're doing it on and by the walls Nehemiah created and built himself. He gets so mad that he starts to force people to work, force people to take oaths to follow God. He beats people up and pulls out their hair. At worst, Nehemiah is a jerk. And at best, he's a very zealous follower of Yahweh, forcing people to follow God. Either way, this is not a victory. As good as a leader as Nehemiah is, and don't get me wrong, Nehemiah is an amazing leader, way better of a leader than I'll ever be. It wasn't enough to change the hearts of the people. It wasn't enough to change the hearts of the people. Nehemiah was giving 190% effort while his followers were giving 10% effort. Have you guys ever been in a relationship like that, in a romantic relationship or a friendship, and you're trying to give 100% or beyond, and your friend or your romantic partner doesn't love you enough to make the relationship work? And so then you try even harder and harder and harder, and the relationship just continues to crumble because it is factually impossible to give more than 100%. That's what's happening here with Nehemiah. He's given 100%. He's been as good a leader as he can be. And then he snaps and he becomes furious and he uses violent coercion to make the people follow God. But friends, you can't make people follow God. You can't do it, because with no Jesus, no revival. So what do we do when our best friend leaves the faith? What do we do when our kids who we raised to follow Jesus are no longer following him? What do we do with our loved one who's about to die, who hasn't said yes to Jesus? What do we do in those situations? Friends, you do your best. You do your best to pray for them, to love for them, and you do it every single day until God says yes or no. You never stop. A lot of us think we can control it, we can force it on them, but friends, we can't force people to come back to the faith, to join the faith, to love God, because that is God's job, not our job. But our job is to set up structures, to set up opportunities for revival to come in. And we can do community groups. We can attend church and bring our friends to church. And we can be prayerful. We can be prayer warriors until their dying day. That's what we do. But ultimately, to save people, to transform them, that is God's job. It's ultimately up to him. Biblical scholar and creator of the Bible Project, Tim Mackey, says it best when he's speaking about the temple, the Torah, the building of the walls in Ezra and Nehemiah. He says, unless God's Spirit does something that we cannot ever coordinate, strategize, plan, or bring about, we are dead in the water. We are just a structure. But at the same time, if we don't maintain these structures and these rhythms to ground our identity in the covenant story, we will not be a people ready to receive revival when it comes. So setting up the temple and reestablishing the Torah, those were good things. Those were part of God's plan. But without God's Spirit ultimately doing the final work, we're dead in the water. No Jesus, no revival. So far, this is the wisdom that we've gained, that we cannot force people to follow God. And the first point was that we are no better than these people. But the third piece of wisdom that we gain from these scriptures is that this is the end of Ezra and Nehemiah, but it is not the climax of God's story. I don't know if you remember all the way back to when Brandy opened our series and she talked about the first verses of Ezra. She went into a lot of the introductory material, but it was so important and it's coming full circle now. It says this in the first few sentences: in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah. That's what I want to focus on. It says, Brandy discussed about this book, Jeremiah, that foretold of an exile into Babylon because the people were sinful, and the destruction of the temple because the people were sinful. It was very dark and gloomy and terrible. But at the very heart of this story lies a very important, hopeful chapter that talks about a time when God would return the people and transform their hearts. It says, "The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the people of Israel and with the people of Judah. It will not be like the covenant I made with their ancestors. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts. I will be their God and they will be my people." Eventually, God is promising to not only bring the people back to the land, but write the law in their brains and in their hearts so that they can obey. No Jesus, no revival. And in addition, when they would hear Jeremiah speaking these words, they would hyperlink to Ezekiel when he says, "For I will take you out of the nations. I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws." So when Zerubbabel and Ezra and Nehemiah go back to the land and they start doing all these things, the people get excited and they say, "Could this be the fulfillment? Could this be the moment that God writes on our hearts and in our minds his law so that we can actually obey him? Is this the moment when God's spirit is gonna live inside of us? Could this be it?" And then any honest, genuine reader reading Nehemiah 13 would say, "This can't be it." And friends, we're not the only ones who picked up on that. You see, the author of Chronicles, he picked up on this as well. Although it is not the last book in our Old Testament, it's the last book in the Jewish Old Testament, right after Ezra and Nehemiah. And what this author was trying to do was to look back from Adam all the way to Nehemiah and say, "Let me summarize this and give commentary to this whole Jewish story." And so he ends with Nehemiah and he's critiquing and summarizing all of Jewish history. And he says, "This can't be it." And we know that because he ends his book with the first verses of Ezra and Nehemiah. And it says this in the very last verses of the Jewish Bible, 2 Chronicles 36:22. "The Lord, the God of heaven, has given me all the kingdoms of the earth, and he has appointed me to build a temple for him at Jerusalem in Judah. Any of his people among you may go up, and may the Lord their God be with them." Boom, and that's it. As if to say, Zerubbabel, Ezra, Nehemiah, we thought that they were gonna put the finishing touches on this transformation of God's people, but man, Zerubbabel's temple wasn't it. The reestablishment of the Torah wasn't it. Nehemiah's walls, they're not it. There has to be something more to this revival, and although the author of Chronicles didn't come to know the climax of God's story, we get to. And friends, the short answer is that it's Jesus the Christ. He is the climax of human history, and he is who we need to be revived. We need him for full transformation. So you see, Zerubbabel's temple was not the final temple. Jesus is the better temple, and he even claimed it himself in Matthew 12 when he says, "I tell you, something greater than the temple is here." Ezra's reestablishment of the Torah was not God's final word. Jesus is the word of God, and through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made, as it says in John 1. Nehemiah's walls were not God's final plan of protection over our hearts and souls. No, Jesus was. Zechariah foretold that God's people will be a city without walls, and I myself will be a wall of fire around it, declares the Lord, and I will be its glory within. Nehemiah chapter 13 is not the final word. It is not the climax of God's story. It is a stepping stone into the most beautiful story ever told, the story of Jesus, the King. It is not enough, though, to know this intellectually, to say we are not better than these people, we can't force people to love and follow God, and that this isn't the climax of human history, no. And it's not enough to say those things in order to build a church and rebuild a city. The thing we need is wholehearted transformation from the one and only King Jesus, his spirit living inside of us, transforming us individually and corporately. No Jesus, no revival. So maybe today is the day for you to start that relationship, to ask God to live inside of you, to ask Jesus to transform you from the inside out. Today is a great day. And maybe for some of you, it's been a long time since you've done that, or maybe you don't remind him every day, but we need to daily go to him in order to be transformed into his image. So tell him. Either way, we need to tell him. Tell him, Jesus, you are the better temple, and I offer and sacrifice my whole self to you, and no other religion or philosophy or obsession will ever be above you. Tell him. Tell him today, Jesus, you are the better Torah because you are the word of God made flesh, and no other words or scriptures or teachers will ever be higher than you in my life. Tell him. Tell him, Jesus, you are the better wall of protection over my life, and I don't want any other human form of protection to ever come before or above you. Tell him. Tell him you love him. Tell him you need him today, because if you do, and you walk alongside him in community, Jesus will not disappoint in transforming you into the human he has always designed you to be. No Jesus, no revival. Let's pray. Our Father, we bow before you and we say that you are the King. You're the King of the universe. You've created us, and you've created us for a specific and awesome purpose. We have purpose because you say we have purpose and you love us. Lord, we are so thankful for that. And so, Lord, I pray that anyone listening to this message would know that, that your spirit, Jesus, would whisper into their ear and into their heart to say that I love you and that I want you. I want you part of my family. And so, Lord, transform us, we ask. Help us to not forget. Help us to not let the important things fall away. And help us to know that you're walking with us every step of the way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now we're going to transition into a time of reflection, and I want you guys to sit wherever you're at and think and pray over these two questions. How am I trying to force others to transform? And what needs to change in my life to prepare myself for revival that only Jesus can bring? Take a moment and look over those questions, pray and think about it, and then we'll close out. Thank you.